Appropriate technology is a method to make do under conditions which are less than optimal, in particular in developing countries. We are going to show a number of techniques whereby the do-it-yourself surgeon can make his own tools, like the door hinge breaker of Gillette blades. The times are over that one could obtain breakable blades all over the world, and now the blade must be broken and bent with a self-made door hinge blade breaker. The size of the cut made with the hacksaw is shown here. One does need, obviously, a vise, a proper heavy vise. When one has changed the shape of the door hinge, we're going to show how to use it for obtaining the right size of flexible blades instead of breakable blades. We're really dealing with handwork, instrument maker's work. A good metal file is indispensable. The burr is taken off. The width of the piece cut off is 1.6 millimeters. Again, we are measuring the width of the size to be broken off, 1.6. A line is carved into the door hinge to regulate the width of the blade cut. The screw serves to tighten the clamp, and for that you need a screw and a washer. The nut is the winged nut of sufficient size to exert good power on the closing of the door hinge blade breaker. Any blade will do. It's clamped, and the line previously inscribed on the door hinge gives you exactly the width of the blade, which must be 1.6. Tighten it, and then the crucial moment of breaking off the blade. We check carefully the place of the cut of the blade in relation to the carved line. Hold it flat against the surface with strong power and vertical so as to hear a snapping moment whereby the blade actually will break. Be very careful because you may cut yourself badly if you're not careful to avoid this. We now have a straight blade which can serve for many purposes. The 1.6 blade. The 1.6 is to be able to insert it into a 16J needle which has to be treated so as to receive the broken off Gillette blade. To shorten it, all one has to do is to cut it with a triangular file. A deep cut will permit you to break off the needle. It will leave a burr, but the burr can be corrected easily with a fine watchmaker's file. The internal burr must also be removed, for which the same file serves remarkably well. Next stage is to insert an 0.5 millimeter wire, spring wire, after which we clamp the needle onto the wire, which will prevent closure of the lumen and will keep the lumen exactly at the desired width of 0.5 millimeters. Now the blade can be inserted, and as the size is exactly right in accordance with the 16J needle, we clamp it and push it deep and into the needle, whereby the knife will stay put and find its own position. The next stage is very important. We have to give an oblique cut to this Gillette blade, and therefore the scissors must be carefully honed and cut parallel to the vice and not obliquely, as we are showing at this moment. Obliquely will not work. A good parallel cut will give you a nice straightforward cut on the Gillette blade. This must be repeated several times during the manufacturing of the blades. There's no need to make any other sharpening act once one understands that this is wrong and that is right. Well, then we cut the blade obliquely, as shown, 45 degrees. The piece that is cut off is destroyed, and we end up with covering the blade with the same cone as the packing of the 16J previously. Now we have a blade which will do a lovely sharp cut in any ophthalmic surgery, for instance in intracapsular lens extraction. It will wash the blood away, and at the same time it has a proper fit to enter the eye at a certain depth. This half-depth incision, as performed here, is a standard method for our intracapsular lens extraction. The next stage we are interested in is the extraction of the nucleus and the total lens, in fact, by means of the cryo extractor. This cryo extractor, which runs on Freon, is easily made by the appropriate technology technique. We start off with a 24J needle, which is broken off by repeatedly bending it and tiring the metal so as to cause it to break spontaneously. The tip of this needle is honed. Then the capillary, which will carry the Freon, is inserted into the plastic tube, which is part of the bottle which will contain the Freon. We have to fasten this polythene tube around the capillary, which is done by heating it up and carefully not to burn it, and the rotate and twist the tube, which will take care of watertight fastening. The tube then is inserted into the bright cryospray bottle, and there is no leakage, which is tested before completing the procedure. The handle of the cryoextractor is a 1cc tuberculin syringe. The long 50 centimeter capillary is given a circular twist for a reason which you will see in a moment. It is inserted into the 1cc syringe up to the correct length, which will bring the tip deep into the 16J needle. In order to avoid slippage of the metal cannula, we are going to fasten it by twisting in the same manner as we twisted the small tube on the bottle. It's warmed up, but carefully not heat it up too much so as to cause it to burn. When the plastic softens, one gives it a twist and a turn, and this will grasp the cannula very efficiently. However, this act closes off the lumen of the syringe. Wherefore, with another 16J needle, we make a hole which will cause venting of the system, whereby the pressure in the syringe will be vented by the hole made next to the capillary. As you can see on the other side, we are measuring the length and pulling up the cannula up to the slotted part, which should prevent extrusion of the tube. We bend again the tip of a 60J needle, put it on an anvil, and deburr carefully. We now are forced to close off the hole of this needle, which is done in a very simple manner with a drop of tin. The technique runs as follows. The other end is closed off with the syringe, which should be with its closed part, preventing the tin from entering the tube. And as you notice, the warmth will cause an expansion, whereby the closed tip of the tin will provide the perfect closure in a manner which will permit the Freon to cool the tip of the cryoextractor. We then break off the needle in a manner which will bring it almost down into the tip of the cryoextractor. It should not rest tightly against the bottom. There should be a little bit of freedom for the Freon to be injected into the tin tip of the needle. We put a silicone tube around it for isolation, and the instrument is now ready for a simple, straightforward cryo extraction. The cooling is done with the bright cryo spray. Any other Freon spray would do. And after a good section is made in this eye with a standard cataract, we are showing how effectively a lens can be extracted with this procedure. Retract the iris quite a lot. Make sure that you have a broad access to the capsule and freeze deeply. Make sure that the nucleus is frozen with the lens. Otherwise, one may break the capsule and cause havoc. slight pulling movements and lifting forward results in extraction in toto of the lens in this typical intracapsular procedure. The pre-placed sutures are closed, and in this manner the patient becomes aphakic. However, the lens to implant in aphakia is the lobster claw lens. The fastening is done with the forceps. One holds the lobster claw lens, the taxilla 5 lens, and the iris is enclavated in the small slots made on the side of the lens. Both sides are fastened in this manner, and the end of the work will be careful closure of the wound. Here we show the manner to bring the iris in position through the slots with a bent needle. This is equally effective as the forceps procedure, however requires slightly more sleight of hand. And this is the combination for an intermediate technological approach to lens implantation after intracapsular surgery. We now must make needles for suturing, including the sutures to be inserted in the needle. The way to do it is as follows. Have a good vise. Drill a hole in it, deep down, a hole of 5 millimeters. A six millimeter cylinder of steel is then inserted and soldered into the hole one drills into the needle bending forceps. For that you need good solder, a good way to clean the surface and make a perfect soldering weld between the forceps and the metal cylinder. Hold it well against the surface of the pliers. The right size is 6 millimeter drill and 6 millimeter cylinder. Then we cut the tip of the pliers, the branches, we now can finish off the works by bringing a 11 millimeter length to the